Bishop has asked that we share reading of scripture from 2 Kings chapter 4 this morning. 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 8 through 26. One day Elisha was passing through Shunem, where a wealthy woman lived, who urged him to have a meal. So whenever he passed that way, he would stop there for a meal. As I said at the earlier services, beware of giving a meal to your pastor. He may stop there again and again and again whenever he passes your way. She said to her husband, "Look, I am sure that this man who regularly passes our way is a holy man of God. Let us make a small roof chamber with walls and put there for him a bed, a table, a chair, and a lamp, so that he can stay there whenever he comes to us." One day when he came there, he went up to the chamber and lay down there. And he said to his servant, Gehazi, "Call the Shunammite woman." When he had called her, she stood before him. He said to him, "Say to her, since you have taken all this trouble for us, what may be done for you? Would you have a word spoken on your behalf to the king or to the commander of the army?" And she answered, "I live among my own people." He said, "What then may be done for her?" Gehazi answered, "Well, she has no son, and her husband is old." He said, "Call her." When he had called her, she stood at the door. And he said, "At this season, in due time, you shall embrace a son." And she replied, "No, my lord, O man of God, do not deceive your servant." The woman conceived and bore a son at that season, in due time, as Elisha had declared to her. When the child was older, he went out one day to his father among the reapers. He complained to his father, "Oh, my head, my head." The father said to his servant, "Carry him to his mother." He carried him and brought him to his mother. The child sat on her lap until noon, and he died. She went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God, closed the door on him, and left. Then she called to her husband and said, "Send me one of the servants and one of the donkeys so that I may quickly go to the man of God and come back again." He said, "Why go to him today? It is neither new moon nor Sabbath." She said, "It will be all right." And then she saddled the donkey and said to her servant, "Urge the animal on. Do not hold back for me unless I tell you." So she set out and came to the man of God at Mount Carmel. When the man of God saw her coming, he said to Gehazi, his servant, "Look, there is the Shunammite woman. Run at once to meet her and say to her, 'Are you all right? Is your husband all right? Is the child all right?'" And she answered, "It is all right. It is all right." This is the word of God for the people of God. It is my distinct honor to bring to you Bishop Yambasu from Sierra Leone, as he has shared with the folks throughout this week and so gracious to share with us here this morning.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. It is joy and indeed a great blessing for me to be here worshiping with all of you wonderful people from Sunday Christ. I've visited the U.S. often and again, but this is my very first time being in this part of the country. And it's so beautiful. But one thing that we have enjoyed for the rest of the 4 days that we have been here has been the wonderful hospitality that we received from you. You gave us your pastor for free to serve us. We want to thank you for that. For the rest of the 4 days, he was always just here with us, and almost anything we needed, he will make it available to us. We want to appreciate you, brother, and may God continue to bless your ministry. We're here for the Sierra Leone reunion, which have been renamed the Servants of Sierra Leone. This is a meeting by a group of missionaries who have served in Sierra Leone, a small country about some 6 million people on the western coast of Africa. They have served in that country, some of them for 40 years. They have celebrated the life of Dr. Guest, who served in that country for well over 70 years. And so every 2 years, these missionaries come together and a reunion to say that even though they are back here as a traditionary, they want to see what they can continue to do in Sierra Leone. And yesterday, as we were listening to some of the stories, very interesting stories, some of them dating as far back as when I was not yet born. And it was a good reunion, and we want to thank God for all that he continues to do in the life of the United Methodist Church. And we're trying to see how many of them were EU, were UBCs, and how many of them were UBCs, how many of them were EUBs, and how many of them are UNCs. And I tested a little bit of UBC for just 2 years in 1966, and then later on it came to United Methodist Church in 1968. But it's been a joyful time for us to be here. You all have just been wonderful, and I want to thank you so much. And I want to extend an invitation to you. You may not have been to Sierra Leone as a missionary, but you could still do something. And every 2 years we meet. Next 2 years, we'll be meeting in Milwaukee. And we want to just say you all are welcome as we are able to do. Yesterday, the pastor was asking me, we had a brief conversation, and he said to me, well, it's very not usual, Bishop, for me to be worshiping with a bishop, to be celebrating with a bishop. And I don't know the culture. I don't want to break barriers. So Bishop, tell me, what do I do? So I said to him, you know what? When I am in your church, you are the boss. So whatever you tell me, I will do it. So he said to me, okay, well, Bishop, I will lead the rest of the service, and you do the preaching. And I said, thank you. And so I'm here preaching. And I do hope that the words I'm going to say today will be words that will touch each of our lives and transform us to the point where we continue to say, we give you the glory. In 2 Kings chapter 2, chapter 4, verse 23, we read the following. When he saw her in the distance, the man of God said to his servant Gehazi, look, there's the Shunammite woman. Run to meet her and ask her, are you all right? Is your husband all right? Is your child all right? Everything is all right, said the Shunammite woman. I want to use as my theme the word Bambalela. Bambalela is a language, an African language that is widely spoken, a Swahili language that is widely spoken in the eastern part of Africa and somewhere in the west, in the central part of Africa. Bambalela simply means don't give up. Can we all say Bambalela? At least for once you have learned an African language. Thank you for doing that. Bambalela. This is one of the finest stories of how God works in our lives and how God transforms our impossibilities to our possibilities. Of how God transforms our tears into joy. Of how God intervenes in situation and works with us through them, so that in the end, we give him the glory. The description of this woman is very, very short. She was a well-to-do woman. And even though it's not written there, but we know by the very kind of thing she did, she was a God-fearing woman. And being a God-fearing woman, she was a hospitable woman, a woman of extravagant hospitality. And we pastors take advantage of that. Preachers take advantage of hospitality. And so it happened that any time Elisha would pass by, because he has experienced this hospitality, he will go through that place and there he will stay for a night or two. But then, in spite of the fact that this woman was rich, she was hospitable and God-fearing, like it happens to all of us. However good we are, there is always a bad beauty about us. She was rich, she was hospitable, she was God-fearing, but she was childless. I don't know about you here, I don't know what your culture is like here, but in Africa, the worst thing that God will do to any woman is to make her childless. You're not respected in society, and nobody would even want to relate with you. And in Africa, it is also associated with witchcraft. Because once you are a woman, it's expected that you must give birth to a child. And if you don't give birth to a child, then something is happening in your life, or maybe in the life of your great-great-grandparents that have been extended unto you. No man will want to come closer to you. And so we could resonate very easily with this passage, because of all the wealth that this woman had, she was childless. And I know it was her desire. Day by day she must have been praying. And no wonder she sees the opportunity the very moment she saw this man of God passing. Maybe if I could invite this man of God here, he would pray for me. And indeed, that was what happened. The man of God prayed for her, and he had a son. And in Africa also, you may have 4, 5, 6, 7 children by our tradition, but if they are all girls, then you have no child. And it's always better for you to have a son than 5 girls, 5 daughters. Because heritage is passed on through the sons. And I am sure that this was the concern. Well, I have this husband, I have been laboring with her all these years. What if I die? Who inherits the property? And so the man of God prayed, and she had a son. But this was the only son. And at the time when this boy grew up, almost at the point of being able to be of service to the mother and to the father, the boy got sick. And again, as it happens in Africa, when the children are well, they are healthy, oh, they are the father's blue eye. But once they get sick, no, go to your mother. You just go to your mother. I don't have time for that. And this is what happened in this passage. This boy was his father, doing everything, but once she said, take him to the mother. And with all mothers, like all mothers, she just took this child, because that was her only hope. And she took the child, placed her on her lap for the whole day. Again, I resonate with that. In Africa, where day by day millions of children are dying, In my country, Sierra Leone, we have the highest infant mortality. They can get sick of malaria or diarrhea, and you just don't know what to do. The mother just doesn't know what to do with the child. She takes that child and puts on her lap until the child will die. But you see, the unique thing about this woman is that because of her faith in God, when this child died, she was not disturbed. Instead, she took the child and placed her on the bed in the very room that this man of God would always stay. And she said to her husband, "Give me a servant and a donkey. I want to go to this man of God." She was rich. She easily would have said to those servants, "Hey, quickly, go call the man of God." But no, this is not an issue that the servant has to treat. She herself has to deal with that. And so she went to the man of God. And the man of God asked, "Is everything all right?" And she said, "Yes, it is all right. Your only son has died, and you say it is all right. Your only hope is gone, and yet you say it is all right." What an amazing woman. Friends, for more than 10 years, Sierra Leone was plunged into a decade of one of the most brutal and inhuman wars that has ever been fought on the continent of Africa. I know some of you may have looked at the movie Blood Diamonds. Part of that movie was shot in Congo, but most of them that were shot in the Sierra Leone. And during that decade-long rebel war, it was like hell was let loose in Sierra Leone. Human beings becoming so heartless as to chop up the hands and the limbs of people. And as a result, about 500,000 people fled that country into other countries. And up to today, most of our doctors, our nurses who were well trained, our professors in the universities are outside of the country, and many of them never return to the country. Half of our people were internally displaced, and another half have their limbs chopped off. But you see, in the midst of all of that, 20 years after the war, many Sierra Leoneans still live in squalor and abject poverty. Many of them, at the day when it is in the morning, they don't even know where to start. We have a huge number of beggars on our street that we never had before the war. The presence of these beggars, the amputees, unemployed youth all over the city, continue to be awful reminders of 10 years of brutal war in that country. But despite these challenges, conditions, anytime you meet a beggar on the street, anytime you meet an employed youth on the street, every time you meet a mother struggling with a child and you ask that mother, "How are you?" You will often hear them say, I tell Papa God, thank you is a Creole language. That's a blend of English and French and the indigenous languages and Portuguese that is widely spoken by almost everybody in Sierra Leone. And I tell Papa God, thank you, simply means I give thanks to God. When you give thanks to God for what? Many times people have asked me, "Bishop, there's something unique about your country." Yesterday I was on the street and I met a beggar. And I asked him how he was doing. And he said to me, "I give thanks to God." You give thanks to God when you have nothing to eat for the day. You give thanks to God when you have no place to sleep. You give thanks to God when you are not employed and your children are starving and dying. And yet you say you give thanks to God. Yes, friends, we have every reason why we give thanks to God. Because God, in the midst of poverty, in the midst of all the hardship and the trouble and the pains that we go through day by day, God becomes so relevant to us. God is our only hope. In a situation where you do not have your bank account, you don't even have food to eat, God becomes our Bambalela. And we say Bambalela, which simply means don't give up. Because we still believe that there is hope. In spite of the fact that the Shunammite woman's son died, she never gave up. Because God is in control. And we believe that in the midst of all the difficulties, God will fix it. Tell Papa God thank you. Yesterday, as we closed the banquet in our celebration, those of us from Sierra Leone led the rest of the group to sing a song that's almost a national anthem in Sierra Leone. Tell thank you, tell him thank you, tell Papa God thank you. Give God the praise, give God the praise for all that he has done for us, we just cannot tell. And we have every reason why we do that. No matter what the trouble we go to, in a country that ranks amongst the poorest nations of the world, God becomes the only authentic and available and sustaining hope. In a country with the highest rate of illiteracy in the world, Sierra Leone, God becomes our hope. In a country that has the highest infant and maternal mortality, God becomes our hope. Bambalela, we don't give up. Some 2 weeks ago, a young woman who happens to be one of our very active members in the Young Women's Network in the Anna Conference and a leader in the Anna Conference was hospitalized. 3 months ago, she gave birth to a child through some cesarean section. And so she went home with the child. But just after a month, her stomach started getting swollen. And it was just getting swollen. Nobody knew what happened. They brought her to the hospital and the tumor was open and the fluid that has gathered there was dislodged. And then they placed sutured again and she went home. A month later, the tumor started to get swollen up again. She was again brought to the hospital, the place reopened, the fluid returned and the place sutured and went home. And so for 3 consecutive times, she's been in and out of the hospital. And she's going so frail. And so 2 weeks ago, I visited her in the hospital. And after praying with her, I said, how are you doing? She said to me, I give thanks to God. I give thanks to God became more meaningful to us after going through 10 years of war. And you give thanks to God because you would have been killed, but the fact that God allowed you to live and you are still living today is enough reason, friends, why we must give thanks to God even though there is no food to eat, even though we are unemployed. Because we believe that God is in control. And the other reason why we give thanks to God was that we still believe that the fact that we are alive today, we are no better in any way than those that have died. But we are living today because we still believe God still has something for us to do now. Think about it. There are many of us who believe that we are alive today because of our money, Because when we get sick, we can easily go to the hospital and we can get any treatment that we want. But think about the millions of people who have money, and money will not heal them. Sometimes I have wondered when I talk with people. Some of us believe that the possessions that we have them because of our intellect. Some of us believe that we have some of this possession because we are hardworking, and we even tend to say to others, he is lazy, that's why he's poor. But here is one thing. God does not bless us because we are handsome or beautiful. God does not bless us because we are educated. God blesses us so that we too can be a blessing to others. Period. And so this woman came to this hospital. And after praying with her, and I said, how are you doing? She said to me, Bishop, I give God the glory. Well, the doctors have said that in 2 weeks' time, if I'm not flown out of this country to Ghana or somewhere to seek a superior medical treatment, I will be there. I know I don't have the money because my background is poor. But I continue to bambalela. I just don't give up. Because I know that God is in control. And he still has something for me to do. 2 days before I came, a father called me and said, Bishop, your prayers have yielded results. Somebody had given us $2,000 to get a return ticket for her and her sister to go to Ghana to seek for medical treatment. And all we need is for you to recommend to us somebody in Ghana that you know to whom they will stay. Don't give up, friends. God is our hope. In other words, friends, when God is in control, God transforms our impossibilities into possibilities. When God is in control, he transforms our tears into joy. When God is in control, he transforms our barrenness into a quiver of children. Don't give up. It is a very common thing, friends, in the country, in Sierra Leone, that many Christian families will wake up in the morning with no bread on the table and no hope of getting anything to eat. Yet, you hear them sing, give God the glory. And Paul resonates with this very well. And in the midst of all his troubles and trials, after several beatings and in prison, and he was facing death, in Rome, he wrote back to the church in Romans. And in Romans chapter 5, verse 3, this is what he said to them. He says, but we glory, but we also rejoice in our suffering. Because I believe that suffering produces perseverance. And perseverance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given to us. Hope, friends, does not disappoint us. Because of our faith in the living God, because of our faith that God can transform our situation, we believe that no matter what happens to us, God is in control. And so I have this message for you this morning. Friends, I know there are some of you here who are struggling in your family. You're struggling with your wife. You're struggling with your husbands. I know in the family, there's some of you almost on the verge of divorce, struggling with all of those family issues. But don't ever give up. Because God is in control. I know there are some of us who are struggling with our children. And we have done everything humanly possible for these children to be the kind of children that we want them to be in life. But we have not succeeded. Don't give up. God is in control. I know there are some of us who are struggling with joblessness. We've applied, we've searched for a job here and there, and we have all the qualifications, but even up to this point, no job. Don't give up. I know there are some of us in this congregation who are now becoming very anxious about our business. The business is dropping. But God is in control. I know there are some of us who are battling with diseases, battling with cancer. In Sierra Leone, we battle with malaria and typhoid and cholera day by day. Your loved one may be battling with cancer. But don't give up. God is in control. I know there are some of us who are battling and struggling with age. Oh, what happens to me in the next 2 years? Yesterday we had one very interesting conversation. The servants of Sierra Leone meet every 2 years. And we were deciding to meet in Milwaukee next year, the other 2 years to come. And many of us, with some of the older folks among us, we are saying, well, would you host us? Well, I don't know what will happen to me 2 years ago. When age begins to set in, when we begin to lose our strength, the next thing that comes to our mind is fear. Fear of tomorrow, what happens to us? But the good thing is that you never created yourself. The God who created you and knows you knows that you have to grow old someday. And He has made His own provision for you. Don't give up. When it is said in Sierra Leone, when we come to the bridge, we will cross it. God does one or two things. When God brings you to the end of the cliff that you cannot jump over, He will either give you wings to fly or He makes you retreat. Don't give up. God will fix it. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.